Here we go. So I think also one interesting point about containers that we should at least touch on a little bit is that with containers you have an user land that you is totally under your control, right? So when you create a container, you should only create a container that runs Bron process. So if you have a solver, it should be the solver that you're thinking about and not systemd or syslog or whatever services are inside of it. I think you should only care about the application you want to run. And by doing so, you can mix and match and play around with the user land that supports this application, right? So I did a little benchmark, it's back in 2014, but it shows that while running natively CentOS 7 with gigaflops in the 4.7 with 8 nodes, when you use an older and more well-hung operating system within a container, you can beat the native performance of the host that is underneath you, because you're using the libraries and the binaries that are more well-hung, more optimized, and which the native system cannot cope with, right? And since a container is just using the syslog interface as a syscall interface, it doesn't have any constraints in the actual performance and can gain from it. And this, I think, it's really encouraging to really care about and tweak the user land that you want to run in. And the same goes for Singularity, I guess, as well, right? So if you tweak the user land within the image that you want to run, so that's true for all the container engines, actually. It's true for containers, so it's true for all of them. You can really tweak your configuration within the image. And also, we already discussed it with containers and with Singularity and with Kubernetes, as it's using Docker containers, you can have very reproducible environments, because what an image gives you is a Merkle duck. So if you have file system layers within your image, you have a representation of this image that if something changes within the container, it will also change. So if you have this image representation here and you put in Docker pull or Docker run this exact string, then you will get exactly what I pushed to Docker Hub and nothing else. If something changes within the image, then it won't start. So I think for papers, research, it's very cool to have this reproducibility, especially for bioinformatics, I guess, because there are a lot of tools that you install and then 5 minutes later there's a new version out there. And keeping or having this in mind, you could also, if you create your Docker files smart so that they are independent of the underlying system, maybe you wget the source code and then make install, you could build a tree of different versions of different libraries of different applications and different configurations and permutate this on your cluster, running it overnight or whatever, and then at the end figure out what is the best configuration, what is the best permutation of compiler flags for the different libraries that you are using, and just by experiment figuring out what's the best way of configuring things. I mean, with this, if you use something smart like continuous integration, so for instance GoCD or Jenkins in the newer version, Jenkins 2, so don't use Jenkins 1 anymore, it's ugly, it's Nagios, this is the new way of doing things. And with automating this, you could easily create this this graph from the earlier slide and make this a job that runs without any user interaction, and then you create a tree of different configurations, different permutations of your application containers, and then just experiment with it. And all of these steps are hashed and addressable, reproducible, so I think this is really something that someone should look into. And if you want to look into it and you don't know where to start, just ping me a mail, I'm happy to help there. Yeah, that's just the pitch, the 4 minute pitch for user land optimization. And now, as Luke is back, we have a little 5 minute chat about Kubernetes, and then we wire in Greg.